potential. You've got LeBlanc, you've got Lee Sin, you've got Tom able to bring someone in with the Abyssal Voyage, but straight up 5v5, unless Finscarin finds some sort of a madman insect play, it's not happening.
Yeah, I mean, Hundred Thieves are going to be able to have a much easier time of choosing when and where you fight when you have go buttons like that Rakan. Pop the ultimate, fly in there, engage the fight. But Evil Geniuses, strong 2v2, both around top and mid lane. Mordekaiser, very scary to gank for any jungler, as you can kind of isolate someone out with that ultimate. And they're going to have a lot of that early game power, as well as the ability to move around the map with Tahm Kench to assist some of those side lanes.
Well, the nice part is, for the side of 100 Thieves, at least you've got Olaf as your jungler, so you don't have to worry so much about the whole Mordekaiser's level 6, I can't go top because all he'll do is Death Realm me and instantly kill me. You can use Ragnarok to break out of things. Olaf's ultimate is a Quicksilver Sash. So that's at least a little bit of an extra edge that you have in picking that champion.
Yep, that is very helpful, but he can still grab up the Aatrox and say, nope, not fighting
you, bro.
No,
be like,
all right,
I'll fight this guy instead. So always got to be careful about it. But here we go. Eyes on the crowd. Everybody's ready to go here for the first Monday Night League matchup. Evil Geniuses and 100 Thieves going head-to-head. One looking to prove that they are the new villain in town. The other looking to keep the success rolling after a comeback win 2 days ago.
It's going to be a pretty interesting one here for me. I am really someone who's going to be having a lot of eyes on Kumo. You know, he did grab that Mordekaiser. You know, someday going to be playing the Aatrox. And Kumo is a guy who really did have a tough time, you know, in his last game in the LCS. And while he did sub in a handful of games for C9 last year, you know, and they had some good results, he didn't always have strong laning, right? And someday, I think, is one of the best laning top laners in the entire league, if not the best laner. So this is another big test for Kumo. You know, you have to kind of prove that you can match up against these top dogs in this lane, because if you're going to have that laning weakness, it's going to be exploited.
And especially on a matchup like this, Mordekaiser versus Aatrox, split push potential on the line, mm-hmm. both of these two wanted to be that 1v1 threat. Nobody's an Ornn. Nobody's waiting to just scale up, buy some items, hit the ulti in a team fight. You need to be able to hold your ground. And falling too far behind will be a death sentence for this entire half of the map, since not only are they volatile, Lee Sin and Olaf, not exactly junglers who are willing to fall behind either.
Yeah, it is really scary if you do start to fall too far behind. As you said, those junglers can get involved. Both mid laners have roam potential here too, with the Ryze as well as the LeBlanc, able to kind of make trips to that side lane. So side lane priority can become really, really big, especially when you realize, you know, as a Mordekaiser, you're the guy with the teleport here. It's Ignite on LeBlanc, so there's a good chance that you're going to be stuck matching up against the Ryze later in the game in a side lane. So if you are very weak at that point, that matchup becomes incredibly difficult too.
Everybody just farming up here nice and early. Doesn't look like we're going to see any of those level 2 ganks that you sometimes see. Lee Sin can go through mid lane early on if you're going for that buff gromp type path. Just sort of get involved, see if maybe you can luck out and grab at a summoner spell, but we won't see Finscarin take that sort of a path here this time around. Also worth noting, he does have the traditional refillable potion start. He does intend to clear the extra camps and not just go straight for PvP gameplay. So we are seeing more of that recently. Sometimes you start with a rejuvenation feed on a champion that wants to build a Tiamat in the jungle, but not here this time around. Meteos is also just going to keep farming up there on the Olaf in the top side. So effective at clearing with that champion. Bottom side, it's Bang and Zazel taking over the lane here nice and early.
Yeah, and you'd like to see Bang actually stepping forward aggressively while he still does have that level of advantage. You want to take every possible opportunity on Senna to actually be farming souls. Hitting these breakpoints every 20 souls, getting the additional range, is so incredibly important. And that's a lot of why you take Glacial Augment, to be able to actually get the slow with the auto of the Q and have the follow-up, because it's that two-hit combo that actually grants you a soul steal from your opponent, as well as that percent health damage. So, you know, really important to be constantly stacking that up, so when you get to later stages of the game, you have an easier time actually contributing, because you're so dependent on having that long range come teamfight time, since right. you don't have a dash and you don't have very quick attack speed. You've got to kind of be this turret.
Ryoma's a little bit far forward here in the lane. Finscarin getting himself involved nice and early. Ryoma with a flash away.
Oh.
Sonic Wave will be blocked by a hero of a minion, and 100 Thieves will keep their mid laner.
Yeah, well played by Ryoma to get out of there, but you've got to say, EG maybe could have played that a little bit better. Jizuke held on to the Ignite. I feel like even just blowing the Ignite and maybe a flash follow for an auto attack could have actually got that kill. Ryoma was very, very low. They missed the chains from Jizuke. They missed the Q from Finscarin, so... You know, well played by Ryoma to get out of there, but I do think EG should have got that one.
Well, EG, they do go after it at first. That does mean the Ryze doesn't have either summoner spell now, so he is vulnerable for a gank. I expect to see Svenskeren come back around within the next 5 minutes. Remember, this is your MVP candidate, your MVP winner from Summer Split. This isn't a guy that you're expecting to just be like, oh, well, all right, summoners are done. See you 20 minutes from now. Yeah. I want to see big plays out of him.
I mean, he's got the giant mural in the LCS studio now at the entrance for the Honda MVP. Larger than life out there, and we'll see if he can get something done. Because yeah, if you're gonna hold on to the flash, you're gonna hold on to the ignite, you want to be able to punish during this time window, and I think they need to be able to do that.
And look at the buy that he made as well. Meteos goes back, he pays the 650 gold to upgrade his smite, get the chilling smite, makes it easier for the first axe. Svenskeren says, I don't need a smite, I just need to be able to hit people harder. Two long swords in the inventory means he's gonna do that much more damage if he makes his way back into one of these lanes. Jizuke again, not quite finding the chains.
You can even see Zazel moving out towards mid lane, you know, anticipating perhaps some sort of a skirmish around there. You know, if he wanted to be in position to make a play, if that were going to be the case.
Nothing quite yet. Tier up and running on the Ryze means he'll start stacking that mana. You can see Bang has the pickaxe as well as the fairy charm, so not quite stacking his tier up yet. But here comes another attempt on the side of Evil Geniuses. Ryoma, the chain's going to lock him down. The damage comes through, and first blood! It's going to find the mark that time.
Yeah, that was really well played, and it only cost them the ignite, so they do have that return gank coming through. Don't have to spend the flash. Still going to have the safety of that. And it was kind of this long trip here from Zazel. He just grouped up with Svenskeren. They actually walked all the way in, were able to, you know, get a deep ward down here in the opponent's jungle, as that kind of arrow I was pointing at. But we're going to see this one more time. You know, this time is able to lock him up, land the chain, and that is what he needs to do. As soon as the chain is there, there's no real chance of getting out of this for Ryoma. It's a guaranteed Q from Lee Sin. It's a guaranteed tongue lash there from the Tomcatch.
And I really like, too, just the tech choice Svenskeren makes. Safeguard to your mid laner first so you don't take one extra turret shot and risk Meteos being able to flash over the wall and finish you off or something. Really clean execution there from the side of Evil Geniuses to make sure they're the first ones on the board. It does give them about a 600 gold advantage over their opponents now, which conveniently is exactly the value of First Blood, so they're not building advantages up elsewhere passively just yet.
And this top lane spot is a little bit awkward, actually, for Kumo, because they don't really have any vision up on this top side, right? You know, you look up here for Evil Geniuses, where's your ward, right? There's nothing on this whole side of the map. So this whole area is pretty dark and full of terrors for Kumo, and that is why Someday has been able to actually hold that wave outside of his turret. Kumo tried to push, but wasn't able to fully reset the wave on the tower, which allowed Someday to actually hold that wave, and thus he has created for himself a 20 CS advantage for 7 minutes.
Bottom side, stunts going in. Him and Cody looking for the 2v2 here up against Bang and Zazel. They'll find a little bit of damage, but they'll take about the same in return, so nothing to write home about there for either side. That farm staying very close between the two sides. Svenskeren now finding himself in a bit of a tussle with Meteos in the river. A TP coming in as it looked like Meteos was backing away. Not exactly the kind of communication you want to see there from 100 Thieves.
Yeah, it seemed like a little bit of a miscall. They perhaps thought it was going to be a more of a committed fight. Someday, thankfully for him, you know, he does have TP advantage, so it's not going to be a massive deficit for him up on that top side. He can run right back up to top lane, but this is giving Kumo a little bit of respite up there, right? He's going to be able to catch back up. He's going to be able to have some time, and in a couple of minutes, they will have a slight window with TP advantage.
Yeah, and it's not so much the fact that you lost something directly through it, as you say, but you did give up what could have been a potential
opportunity cost.
Yeah, the opportunity cost is really big there, as Ryoma takes a lot of damage here in the mid lane. Jizuke playing these little trades well, making sure he's coming out on top little bit by little bit.
And I think really what they were hoping to do was get a kill on Sven, take him down, and lead that into a dragon, right? But instead, that TP play doesn't work out. Svenskeren actually sees Meteos backing off after taking the blue buff. So it's going to be Svenskeren here who gets to actually start up this Cloud Dragon, and it should be uncontested because Olaf has reset, Ryoma's running out of base, the Ryze ultimate's on cooldown. No way they're going to get over there.
But important to keep in mind, as we've stated previously here in week one of season 10, the way the Drakes have changed, getting a couple of them early on isn't going to be quite as impactful in terms of the bonuses they convey your team. It's really just about letting your opponents know, hey, we're starting to work towards that soul clock. You've got to be prepared. No reason to start wiping the sweat off your forehead from a single Drake. but it is a nice thing to be able to pick up here early on.
Yeah, it's securing yourself an additional way to win the game later on, right?
Yep.
You know, it's saying, hey,
an investment.
Exactly. You know, we'll spend a little bit of time doing this. You know, you get some alt CDR, which is kind of nice. You know, there's some pretty lengthy ultimate cooldowns here when you're looking over at the 100 Thieves side. You know, over 2 minutes on both the bot laner's ult. The Ryze ultimate is 3 minutes. You know, these are ones that are, you're going to get a pretty big chunk of time off of that. So it's pretty nice, but it is mostly about being able to threaten that soul potentially later on, which we know is going to be either Infernal or Ocean, because the next draft is going to be Mountain.
Yep.
And those are two of the best ones to get.
Yeah, everybody loves the Ocean Soul in particular. Infernal Soul giving you that extra burst. Ryoma tries to get away, but the second part of the chain is going to find him. A little bit more damage.
Oh!
Almost there. Happy Feet steps right out of the way of the beam. Almost sniped from bottom lane, but not quite.
I gotta give some credit to Ryoma to have the confidence to not use the flash there. He barely stepped out,
yeah,
and he's like, no, I don't need the flash.
That clipped him on the heels, yeah, for sure. He felt the wind
by his
butt.
Yeah. Yeah, that's definitely, you like it, you like it. So confident play there, looking for the sidestep. And now it is gonna be about this Rift Herald play. They're trying to answer back. 100 Thieves have TP'd over into the pit, and their bot lane is here as well. So five members in the area already. Kumo is locked under his turret. Jizuke is heading bot lane, so this is going to be 100 Thieves grabbing the objective.
I really like that call. They know LeBlanc doesn't have her full kill potential. She just used Ignite. They know Bang doesn't have a huge team fight ultimate with the Senna ulti. That's a green light to grab something and make sure that you're punishing your opponent's unsuccessful play.
Yeah, and Jizuke was out of mana, so they knew he had to go back to base. He's not playing teleport, so Ryan was going to be out on the map much more quickly, and they're kind of using that tempo advantage to now drop Herald here, and they're just going to try to bully Kumo out of here.
But this is what you've got to be careful of. Remember, Kumo is able to drag someone into the death realm if you try to turret dive. The turret can still shoot you as well. It makes it into a pretty precarious situation. Shelly's going to be beaten down. The turret's still at two plates. 100 Thieves back away.
Yeah, that was actually pretty close to not even getting the charge off, because the eye did actually get popped there and took a fair bit of damage. On the bottom side, Jizuke is going to be getting most of that gold back, if not even more, and he's actually getting it solo, right? He's working on that third plate, so
yep.
You know, 100 Thieves not getting, I think, nearly as much as they were hoping for. The Tahm Kench ultimate from Zazel really shedding a lot of that aggressive play down. They
Thumper
were hoping,
ambitious.
I think, to try to push him off the turret and, you know, punish Kumo. Instead, it's three solo plates probably that are going to go to Jizuke on the bottom side.
Well, with no turrets having been taken, we're already into the Australia lanes. Everything's been flipped topsy-turvy. Bottom laners in the top side, but it's mid laners in the bottom side right now, as both of those big bruisers in the top lane head towards mid themselves. You can see boots completed on both sides to counteract the other's main damage type. Working towards those first items, usually Liandry's Torment for the Mordekaiser, Black Cleaver for the Aatrox. Warrior up and running on both of these junglers. A lot of damage potential here for these guys. Still only one kill on the board here, 12 minutes into the game. 200 gold separating the teams. You can see Jizuke and Bang topping out the gold charts. Cody Sun a whole 2 gold behind his lane opponent.
Ooh,
so
devastating.
Very close there.
It is interesting to note that Someday has actually kind of skipped over the CDR garage sale. He didn't go for the call field. That
yeah.
really is the standard build, to actually just grab the Kindle Gem, grab the call field, rush towards CDR. Instead, he's going for that faster item completion, right? So he'll be kind of weaker on the way, but when he completes that Black Cleaver, he's going to have, you know, an earlier power spike that he can then use to try to bully out Kumo. And we'll see if he's going to be able to accomplish anything when that item completion does come through, because he's only 400 gold away, really, from finishing that off.
Kumo has managed to staunch the bleeding pretty well in terms of the CS situation that he was in such dire straits on before. Yeah, he's still down 20, but it's not like it's grown to a 30 or 40 deficit, and Someday's just continuing to blast him in that lane. You can see the next Drake will be spawning here sub 30 seconds. We'll see if this is worth fighting over for either side. When you're on such even territory, you would think that they'd be looking for any sort of an opportunity to get themselves ahead. Bottom side River Control is currently owned by 100 Thieves, who want to shove this mid lane wave out, and then we'll see how many bodies they send towards that pit.
Yeah, I'll be interested to see who goes for it. I think, you know, neither team is going to be too concerned about it, because individually, I think this is kind of the worst dragon, you know, for this setup. There's not a lot of pure tanks, not a lot of resistances actually being built up, so the bonus MR as well as armor is not going to be the biggest of deals. EG would like to continue stacking, but I think you're okay to give up like a dragon like this as long as you're getting farm advantages elsewhere, gold advantages elsewhere, because the individual dragon is really not very threatening.
And as we're 13 and a half minutes into the game and we're seeing the teams group up in larger posses, getting ready to fight each other here, you can see a 3v3 potentially breaking out. Stun's going in, a lot of damage coming out onto Spin Scare, and he'll be finished off. Cody Sun grabbing a kill as Meteos now has to retreat. Ragnarok still ready to go. Ryoma keeping Suzuki at bay here in the bottom half of the river, but Meteos is dangerously close to dead, having to pop the ultimate defensively. Bang tries to shoot the ulti ahead, but he's not able to predict it correctly. Meteos, knowing that would happen, stays out of the way and gets himself out.
Yeah, really nice job though by Bang and Zazel bullying out multiple members here from 100 Thieves, because that initial play, as Suzuki could come over the wall here.
Suzuki looking for something, he won't find it. Meteos gets back to base just in time.
That initial play makes you think, oh, Sven's dead. That's the dragon for 100 Thieves. But because of all this damage and utilizing the Glacial Augment slow on those auto attacks, Sven is chasing them down and punishing them so heavily that they can't actually continue. But we are getting to see the hard engage I talk so much about in draft really shown off, right? This is the power of a pick like Rakan. You see someone there, you have an additional member, you say, guess what? We're fighting. You don't have a choice about it. We are going to start this up. But because of all the damage that Bang got back, it is 100 Thieves that actually have to reset off this, and it is Evil Geniuses who are going to grab their second dragon of the game and going to be really happy about that one.
And as the Infernal Drake blazes and burns away the walls into the jungle, that feels good as a champion like Olaf or a champion like Ryze. The less walls that are around, the less disadvantages you have against champions that do have dashes or blinks, makes it easier to run them down, makes it easier to just utilize your movement speed to have an advantage in the fight. We'll see how that plays out, if it ends up making any sort of a difference here as the game pushes forward. Two Drakes to zero for the side of EG, so if they get the next two, that's when 100 Thieves has to start actually worrying. The Infernal Soul, very powerful, especially when you've got the pick potential already with a team like LeBlanc in these.
And this is really kind of demonstrating the two schools of thought on how to play around the new Rift, right? We have Evil Geniuses who are actually focusing a lot of their time on taking the dragons. We have 100 Thieves who they invested their time in taking that Rift Herald. And the argument is essentially this, that you can give up the first two dragons while extending what you're hoping is a gold advantage by taking the Rift Herald, and then start fighting at that third dragon when you are more powerful than your opponent, right? So we're going to see if that comes to fruition, because somebody does get solo turret gold largely because they actually had that turret low from the Rift Herald.
Right. That gold advantage you're talking about right now hums the tune of about 1K, a little bit under for the side 100 Thieves. Will that be enough? That's the question of the day, as Finn Skaren's chasing after Meteos here, running towards the top side.
Ryoma.
Meteos going into the ultimate, looking to stay alive, but he's going to be taken down by Bang. The burst is there. Evil Geniuses get the first kill of the fight. Zazel's having to go into the stasis, and EG decides they're going to leave Zazel to the wolves. They go top to help Kumo instead, someday retreating into the safety of a Realm Warp, bringing his teammates to him. And 100 Thieves will end up losing one there, and it's EG who now have priority over the topside river. They will go into the Rift Herald.
Yeah, Kumo just isolates Someday, and even though Someday I think was going to win that 1v1, it doesn't matter because Someday, the strongest member for 100 Thieves right now, is isolated out of the fight. Meteos was killed off very early on, and the rest of the 100 Thieves were getting blocked out by Zazel, who just pops a stopwatch and buys so much time. So, you know, 100 Thieves didn't have the opportunity to connect with those targets that they really wanted, and as a result, it's again EG that is pushing their opponents out of the map and getting that objective. So, going to be a Rift Herald each, and two dragon advantage for EG. The gold lead really not meaning anything at this point. 400 Thieves, only a couple hundred.
Yeah, I like how you talk about the different philosophies around how to play around Drakes. Same thing, there's two philosophies with Mordekaiser ult. Either take the guy that you can beat up, kill him instantly, or just say, all right, I know I'm not going to kill you, but you're not allowed to do anything for 7 seconds. Just throw him in the cage, walk around in circles, dance if you want to. As long as they're not in the fight, you're winning.
Yeah, I mean, if Someday is the guy with the gold lead, if he's the guy that you're worried about popping off, as Jizuke has him very low there, Someday going to slink away. But yeah, to your point, you just pop him in the ult. He's not going to be able to kill you really quick. You know, you have a really fat W shield. Obviously, the passive does make it, so you kind of have to respect the Mordekaiser, even if you are ahead. And they just did a really good job of kind of isolating these fights and picking their battles.
Meteos and 100 Thieves walking up, trying to get down a little bit of vision here in the EG jungle, but they won't be able to do too much. Zazel's on duty there, using the control wards, keeping that vision down. considering there's still only one turret taken in this game 18 minutes in, neither side's gonna feel too super confident about walking into the enemy jungle just yet. It's very easy for their opponents to have nearby bastions to retreat to if they find themselves in a bad spot. But now Kumo getting into a 1v1 here yet again, up against Someday in the bottom side. Not gonna find the hit there with the mace. Meteos has made his way down into the fight now too, and as soon as that death realm fades, Kumo's gonna be in a real rough spot. Bang!
Whoa.
Bringing in the cavalry with the ultimate. Someday's gonna dash over the wall, keeping himself alive as well, and both teams are so quick to get everybody involved.
The global play there was fantastic from EG. It looked like 100 Thieves are gonna be the ones in the advantage because Meteos is there waiting for the ultimate to expire. But all of a sudden, Bang throws his ultimate in. There's a fast shield now on Mordekaiser. In comes Zazel with Svenskeren. Not only that, they're always getting something off of the HP advantage. It feels like EG wins the skirmish, and they're always able to then take something afterwards. And this time, it is the big reward of that mid-tier one.
See if this fight in the top side turns into much of anything. Jizuke, he will get the root onto Ryoma, which will stop him from escaping. Jizuke still looking to maybe find a little bit more, and he has got it! Solo kill for the EG mid laner.
That is a close one. Jizuke not even needing his ignite, which he had used in that bottom side, does take down Ryoma. But I've got to say, mistimed the Seraphs a bit. He didn't get the full value out of that Seraphs. He had used it actually after most of the spells had already come out from Jizuke, and that little difference there made a really big deal as Jizuke gets a solo kill. The Infernal is up on the map. 100 Thieves looking to be in position to start it, but they have to wait for Ryze, who has no teleport and no ultimate to get over here. So if EG get any sort of chip damage down, they could push 100 Thieves out again.
Yeah, let's rewind 4 or 5 minutes here where you were talking about you give up the first two Drakes in exchange for a gold advantage. That gold advantage has now gone the other way.
Uh-huh.
EG has completely evaporated what 100 Thieves was working for here in the beginning, and now it's the Thieves who find themselves in a pretty rough spot as this third Drake is alive. Evil Genius is ready to go. They've got the whole team already ready. Cody Sun, 60% HP now. You are the Xayah, so you've got Flash, you got the ulti. There's plenty of get out of jail tools here for this AD carry. But 100 Thieves have got to respect the control over the area Evil Geniuses now have.
And the threat now from LeBlanc to actually just kill Cody Sun. You know, he went in without Ignite, took Cody Sun to half. Now he's got stunned to a third. Jizuke just solo won EG the Dragon here. This guy is playing so confidently, just charging forward into his opponents, being able to get multiple chunks down on the bot lane members of 100 Thieves, and there's not even a fight because Jizuke just played too damn well.
And now, EG has put this game on soul point for 100 Thieves. We talk about how it's not a big deal when you've got one. All right, it's okay when you've got two. Every one of them matters now, and it's a situation that feels so hard to play into. Meteos in some trouble. Jizuke finding some damage onto him, and this guy's just all over the map.
He's everywhere.
Bop, bop. Bop! Every single time, you're losing half your HP.
This is some incredible LeBlanc play here from Jizuke. And, you know, if you listen to some of the preseason interviews, Zazel, Svenskeren talking about Jizuke, he's this madman that they're trying to keep on a leash who's going to go and look for these crazy plays, and a guy that has the skill to pull them off. And we are seeing that here as he has gotten multiple chunks across the map that are really rewarding EG with some of these big objectives. And now 100 Thieves is one mistake away, one pick away from giving up Soul, right? It's not just the next dragon that you have to worry about. Yep. The one after. They're going to have so many chances to actually claim Soul, which is that permanent game-long buff.
And look at the itemization on Jizuke. This is exactly where a LeBlanc that's roaming around like this wants to be. Mm-hmm. Ludens and double spell pin. This is that mid-game, now you see me, now you don't, that's your health bar type of gameplay that LeBlanc is known for. When you look at the items on the enemy side, yeah, Someday's going to be tanky against some magic damage. He's got Hex Drinker, he's got Treads. Meteos might as well be an AD carry. He has no defenses against this whatsoever. Mm-hmm. He'll pop as fast as Cody will. And now we're going to see Jizuke find himself in a bit of a rough spot. Svenskeren showing up immediately to protect his mid laner. Here comes Zazel. Here comes the counterattack. Ryoma will realm warp away and dodge out of that one. But can Meteos find the kill onto Jizuke? It doesn't seem so. Stunt's gonna be fighting here on the other end of the fight. Kumo and Zazel keeping the rest of the thieves away. And somehow, in all of that, neither side loses a man.
Yeah, Meteos running between the two mid lane turrets there to escape. They are still on the chase a little bit here. We'll see. Oh, he's getting pretty greedy going for this red buff. He might just be caught.
It is a deadly sin, but fortunately the blast cone forgiveth and will let him get away over the wall. Red taken by Bang, and Meteos will see another day.
Yeah, I've got to say I'm really liking how EG are playing this. They're staying proactive. They know they don't want to just be kind of farming it out and playing slow against this type of composition. You know, a trap we see so many LeBlancs fall into is they have a strong early game, and then they just go match side lane against someone like Ryze and farm for 20 minutes. And all of a sudden, oh my god, the Ryze is winning the game. Who would have thought?
It's like, who would have guessed a late game champion won in the late game?
Yeah, but we're seeing Jizuke constantly be proactive. Yes, he has to go respond to some of these side lanes, push out the wins, but then he's looking for picks. He's moving around, trying to find pockets of vision that he can attack his opponents from. And that's what you need to do on the LeBlanc. So I want to see that continued confidence, him and Svensgeren, as well as Zazel, moving around the map, getting vision that their opponents then have to contest, where Jizuke can punish.
2 minutes until the fourth Drake of the game spawns with three under the belt of EG. 100 Thieves no longer has the option to ignore it. We've already mentioned this, but it's very important to keep everyone aware of exactly how close that is. Mm-hmm. You see teams sometimes prep for objectives very early on. 2 minutes is not unheard of. 100 Thieves cannot be behind the pace of their opponents once that spawns.
Yeah, they really can't. They've got to be first to the scene. They have to be the ones who are actually starting that up. And it's even more difficult based on the fact that it's a Lee Sin on the other team. So even if you have control of the pit, you know, we've seen so many Lee Sins come over the wall, steal that away, you know, utilizing QXQ damage.
It's literally what happened in the Academy game right before this. Team Liquid, mm-hmm. Academy, not looking like they're going to be winning this game. They look like they are going to be winning this game, excuse me. And then TSM just says, nope, see ya. Yeet the guy out of the pit, steal the Drake. All of a sudden, wham, bam, you win the game. It's such a difficult situation to be in against that champion. Kumo going to be defending here in the bottom side, 1v2. It's Someday and Meteos making sure they've got priority over this bottom lane. 45 seconds till that Drake spawns. Meteos heading back towards the mid lane now. But nobody on EG is in a position where they could be caught out.
Yeah, and they're resetting at an appropriate time here, right? You need to be back in base and out on the map before it spawns, to be in position getting vision before your opponents are actually at that spot. And that is something that both teams are prepared to do. 100 Thieves trying to get pressure here in mid lane. They are already grouped up 5 men strong. And they would love to get a pick here, and they might have one at Jizuke.
Oh, Jizuke! He walks right into the brush. Ryoma is ready and waiting. Realm Warp going to be coming through. Ryoma does end up putting him in a spot where he can't get away. It's Stunt that grabs the kill, but that is so important.
Yeah, the face check there onto Ryoma, who then just kind of corrals his opponent. Realm Warping behind him, so he has to go back to the distortion, but Stunt is already there waiting. That kill will give 100 Thieves the opportunity to be the ones to start up this dragon. We'll just have to see, though. Can Svensgeren and Kumo work some magic? Can they actually try to steal this away? Oh, he missed you.
He misses the Sonic Wave. Stunt's going to continue buying time, and 100 Thieves have got themselves 5 more minutes before the soul is a potential again.
And that shows the value of pulling that dragon back, of not actually fighting inside the pit, right? Yep. And that was just out of range for Svensgeren. Had they been a little bit more lazy, a little bit more rushed on that dragon take, well, Svensgeren could have actually potentially stolen that away. Had that Q hit, I think he would have had the potential to just grab that and take the soul. But 100 Thieves do get another lease on life, avoiding that soul. And as you say, they're going to have to keep fighting at every single one of these. Ryoma did know his opponent is coming. He sweeps out the brush, sees that it is empty, had already spotted him on the ward, and then just drops the Realm Warp behind Jizuke. Jizuke had to come back. Cody's on in stunt waiting. No way out from him for that position. So really well played there by Ryoma, and getting a pick back, that was a big one for the team.
100 Thieves keeping the hope alive. Remember, the win that they got on Saturday was against the Golden Guardian squad that 4-0'd them in Drake's, that got the soul early, and it was a steal of an Elder Dragon that ended up bringing 100 Thieves the win. Now, whether or not you want to say that that had to do more with 100 Thieves playing it well or Golden Guardians playing it incorrectly, that's up for discussion.
Some of column A, some of column B.
Yeah, a little bit of both, I think a lot of people would have at least some agreement with. But EG wants to make sure they don't fall into that same trap, right? But the game is so very close. 27 minutes in, only 5 kills between them, and 500 gold separating the squads.
We are seeing Someday, though, create these side lane advantages, right? He's up 40 CS now. He is winning out on these trades. He's 1,300 gold ahead of his lane opponent. He has the level advantage. So, you know, if that is a way to create opportunities for 100 Thieves, because they really do want to be playing in these side lanes. If you have Aatrox beating the Mordekaiser, Ryze is going to start beating Jidouke on this LeBlanc here. So, you know, that is kind of the worry for EG. They want to push the pace. I talked about their lack of engage. It hasn't been, you know, a big deal thus far because they have been really good at playing around vision, about finding picks and chunks like this. But the later you get into the game, the harder and harder it's going to get. So they've got to be on point, and they've got to make sure that they secure a major advantage, such as the Soul or a Baron, you know, in this next, say, 5-minute range, or it could get tough.
Remember what I said earlier about Meteos essentially being as tanky as Cody's son? Well, Jidouke pops them like a balloon, and that is a pick that Evil Geniuses needed. Now they've got everybody pushing up. It's Kumo in the bottom lane, rest of the team here as a 4-man squad in mid. Ryoma's gonna be locked down by the change. Follow-up damage coming through. Nice kick out of Svenskeren. He will end up falling, but it's yet another kill onto Stunt. 2 out of 3 100 Thieves kills on their support, not where you want to see them.
Yeah, and that's the mid laner dying for the jungler, which is a great trade, right? You know, Ryoma is such an important part to the 100 Thieves squad, and Svenskeren going down to grab that kill, well worth it. That's a lot of the wave clear for them, a lot of their side lane strength, so, you know, things are going to get tougher for 100 Thieves. Jidouke, again, finding plays for the squad. You know, he has so much confidence to go forward, you know, into this team and look for the pick. Here is the follow-up play after Meteos had already been killed off. Jidouke again starting it off. He lands the chain, which then prompts the rest of this engage. Ward hop forward, kick flash, really nicely done to buffer that from Svenskeren. And it's that chain, followed up by the root from Senna. You know, no way out for Ryoma once he had gotten locked up there. Maybe could have early flashed and tried to break that chain tether. That probably would have been his only hope of getting out.
And that timing from Svenskeren was so perfect, because as soon as Ryze set his first foot inside the range of the blast cone, Svenskeren says, nope, we got to kick him now. Mm-hmm. And boom, he's kicked right out of the way. Well done by the side of EG, keeping this game as close as it has been for the entire time they've been playing it. 60 seconds until the next Infernal Drake spawns. 100 Thieves and Evil Geniuses, nobody really has a lot of vision or preparation in the bottom side of the river here just yet. You can see EG grouping up in the mid lane. They want to shove this out. 100 Thieves here to answer. And we'll see if EG puts themselves in a spot where they give up a crucial pick again and aren't able to contest it.
You know, the other advantage that EG have at this point, because it's so critical for 100 Thieves to stop every dragon, if 100 Thieves overforce on that dragon, you know, it's not like they get a soul on this next one. EG can actually potentially trade for Baron. They are moving down here, though, so it does look like they want to try to contest, want to try to grab this soul right here and right now. So fighting over vision going to become very, very important. Someday has arrived. All 10 members playing around this dragon pit.
Someday trying to get a little bit of a knock up there on to Bang, who's saved by Zazel from the chains. Stunt's going in, but good lord, man, he is down. Someday, 15% HP, he's on the run. Svenskeren's gonna be taken low, but Meteos is sniped out by Bang. Kumo's gonna fall, it's a 2-for-1. Cody Sun barely gonna be keeping himself alive there with the ultimate. Has to flash out of the way of the big ulti from Bang. And with a fight win there, EG have control over the Drake pit.
Yeah, this should be theirs. Meteos is down. There's no real chance of a steal or even a contest here. They're gonna TP back in. They feel like this is something they need to fight over. They do have double teleport available, but
they
haven't even get in.
Everybody TPing in for this one. Zazel's barely getting himself away. The Drake is secured. Svenskeren's over the wall. He's got the safeguard to make sure of it. Bang's gonna keep himself on the run now. Svenskeren doesn't want to go anywhere close to this fight. Bang's got the camouflage. He's gonna look to dodge away from Someday. Zazel's here. Nope, all right, they don't even need to do it. Everybody from EG survives with Infernal Soul in the bank. Things have just become pretty dire here for 100 Thieves.
Yeah, that is such a big deal. 100 Thieves, even after the Soul went down.
Oh, no.
No way.
Okay, he's not going to go all the way.
I mean, he's level 16. The distortion cooldown's pretty low, but he's not going to chase. And 100 Thieves felt committed to that. I think when you see that long chase, they are looking then to say, all right, well, we lost it. But what if we get some kills? Can we take the Baron afterwards, right? They wanted to be able to try to get something back, but now you've given over this permanent buff here, and let's watch this one more time. It is Kumo, you know, going forward here onto Someday, pops the ult, getting a lot of damage down, and at the same time, Stunt was looking for this engage, just gets kicked out by Svenskeren, looks for the re-engage, and just gets absolutely lit up by Jidouke, who had been such a playmaker for the squad, and now Meteos slowed down, and he's just shredded through. Olaf, when you are not ahead, you are behind, it always feels like, on this champion, and he is just getting absolutely blasted.
tragedy there for 100 Thieves, who also used a triple teleport to try to contest the Drake afterwards, meaning all of those critical summoner spells are down.
I mean, I think that tells you right there how dire they felt the situation was, how important they think that soul is. You don't triple TP into a contested dragon without your jungler if you don't think, hey, we're going to lose the game right here. So they are up against it. I will say Cody-san's still in a good spot, has three items plus the QSS. We know how good his late game team fighting can be, and with that Zyrakon combo, if they find the right engage, there is an opportunity to make something happen.
Infernal Soul, very scary, essentially like a Ludens Echo on every champion. Tahm can't just have a nuclear tongue every time he slaps it out there and gives you a lick. But you've got to be so careful in respecting what could happen if five members of a team all hit you at once. That's an extra 600 or so damage just being piled on there. 100 Thieves trying to maintain some control on their side of the map. Someday will grab the red buff right before EG is able to make their way over. Both the Sonic Wave and the Tongue Lash are going to miss the 100 Thieves top laner. But now that the Drake is not a concern for them for the next 3.5 minutes, Baron very well could be, and you can see EG setting up around the pick.
Look at those three picks in mid lane. They have a line of four wards right there.
It's like
you
Scion,
shall not pass.
It's Scion Speedway. They're just making a track for everybody to run around.
That was very, very good vision in that area.
They're just patting vision score. Pass. That's all.
They actually missed one of the pink wards. So that's the strategy. You put three, they're like, well, we got
two. We can only kill two.
Surely.
It rounds up to 100%.
There's no more left. There couldn't be a third.
Well, the side of 100 Thieves is doing a good job here, sweeping out some of the wards in the top side of this river, making sure that they take the advantage while their opponents are back. Two control wards here in this brush. Stun having to be careful. He's very aware of exactly how mortal he is after the way that last team fight went. EG continuing to maintain control over the flow of the game for now. They're the ones pushing up here in mid lane. Five men strong. Nobody going to be manning that side lane. We've seen Kumo down there practically the whole game. Jizuke has always been jumping around, looking for some picks, looking to chunk someone out. But everybody's just chilling here in the mid lane. So much range on Bang on this Thina.
92 stacks.
That means he's only a few away from having that fifth big buff coming in, considering it is every 20, and that means his range will just be absolutely ridiculous. You saw that's the reason Meteos died in that last team fight. Bang shot him from seemingly two states away.
Yeah, I mean, he has 100 bonus range already, so he's sitting at 700 range, you know, without the rapid fire active. That's an 850 range auto. That's like a full screen practically.
Yeah.
At that point, and when you get tagged by that and chunked out early in a fight, it feels damn bad. It's also really hard to engage on this guy with a Guardian Heal Tahm Kench standing in his back pocket.
Well, 100 Thieves are making the call. They are not willing to sit idly by while their opponents just control the game. They're going after the Baron. They've got it down to about 2/3 HP. Bang gonna go ahead, shoot in that ultimate. Jizuke, he's got some burst, and it's Bang who grabs the kill onto Cody. Ryoma's looking to get himself out, but Bang's got a double. 100 Thieves are collapsing, and Bang is destroying everyone. The damage continues to pour in. Kumo's gonna grab the kill onto Stunt, and someday we'll hobble away from this fight.
Cody's son got absolutely erased there. No time to react, no time to get that ultimate or flash off. Jizuke and Bang, it looked like, you know, grouping up there and just absolutely knocking him down. EG gonna grab the Baron, and it feels like they have full control over this game.
6-0-3 on Bang Senna, providing the extra burst damage to make sure Cody's gone before his finger can find the R key. And that is just such a big win here for Evil Geniuses. Nearly 5,000 gold ahead without the Baron even dead yet. That'll be another 1,500 in their pockets. Bang and Zazel coming back over. Normally Senna teams, one of the weaknesses of it is it doesn't take Baron as fast because of the low attack speed. But when it's totally uncontested, it's not too big of a concern.
Yeah, Mordekaiser with Liadrin plus that passive can burn through it pretty quick. So here it is one more time. It actually started out okay, 400 Thieves, but then Sunday is going out of the top side. You see this engage come through. Jizuke flying forward, getting so much damage down, plus Bang putting some damage down over top of it. The Infernal Soul proccing, and Cody Sun just absolutely disappeared. And then the chase is on, looking to take them down. Kumo grabbing his first kill of the season here, taking out Stun.
And now, Elder Drake's on the table. This is a win condition if you're 100 Thieves. Remember, it doesn't matter how many Drakes you have.
How do you win the fight?
If you get it, that's the question. That's the million-dollar question here for 100 Thieves. They want to try to contest EG for this. You know if you end up giving your opponents both Uber buffs, the game is just over when they have the soul as well. You cannot concede this fight. 100 Thieves have to look for an opportunity. You would think that it needs to be a huge engage from stunts, but he's already down to 20% HP. He's nearly dead. There's no way for him to engage this fight, and Evil Geniuses maintain control. Bang looks to go for the snipe. Stunt, if anybody so much as breathes on him with that Infernal Soul ready, the man is dead. Drake, so close to gone. Meteos looking to run in. Can he feel it? No, he can't! A valiant effort, but that Viking's going to Valhalla, and EG are going to the 100 Thieves base.
Yeah, Meteos had to try there. That was the last hope, I think. EG looking to close this one out, get the first win for them back in the LCS.
Here they go. It's mid lane inhib gone. It's everybody marching down the mid lane. 100 Thieves, make your stand. Nexus turrets under fire. One is gone. Two will go. And Ryoma and the rest of the 100 Thieves will have no say in what happens here. Someday gone. Ryoma gone. Everybody gone. And Evil Geniuses get their first win.
I've got to say, man, welcome to the LCS, Jizuke. What a game from the Italian Stallion on LeBlanc.
His teammates are saying he's a madman. Well, those are the kind of plays you want to see on your LeBlanc players. All over the map, popping health bars left, right, and center. He was critical in keeping that team where they needed to be in the mid-game to get them to where they could get the soul and get that Baron.
He was so proactive. You know, we saw the attention there. Svensson, Jizuke, even Zazel coming up towards that mid lane, trying to get the initial lead for Jizuke. But he did not sit on that by any means. He was very active across the map, getting so many chunks onto their opponents, granting them, you know, full priority around the Dragon Pit, pushing Meteos out of his jungle, finding straight up 100 zeros like that kill on Cody-san by the Baron Pit. This was a fantastic LeBlanc game, and that's the kind of play you need from your mid laner when you're coming over here and you're looking to try to attack the top of the table.
And I want to harken back to what Prolly said right before the desk threw it to us. He said that the improvements 100 Thieves had to make seemed minor, and Evil Geniuses seemed to have a lot more improvements they needed to make compared to their Sunday performance. This team looked much better than the team I saw play yesterday.
Yeah, they really did. And I think that's something that a lot of EG fans could be very, very excited about when the mid and jungle is working that well together.
Yeah.
You know, people had a lot of questions about, well, which is the dominant lane that Svensson's supposed to play around, right? You have the MVP jungler, but if your lanes aren't winning, if your lanes aren't being dominant, where is he supposed to go? Well, I think we kind of got that answer right here.
And we saw 100 Thieves try to take the Olaf into the Lee Sin, go for that preemptive counterpick we talked about. But Svensson, he was there. He found some critical kicks. He made the plays work. And that's what you want to see. That's why you pick up an MVP jungler. And for more on the victory, Avli is standing by with EG's mid laner.
Thanks, guys. I've got the Italian Stallion right next to me. Jizuke, congratulations on picking up EG's first win. You were destroying people on LeBlanc. Completely popped everyone on 100 Thieves. Were you expecting them to give up a little bit more of a fight?
I thought that I would have done so much more, actually. But yeah, the fights I took, except the one where Ryze killed me on the bush on mid lane, I think except that I played fine, I guess.
Well, this is your first weekend playing in the LCS coming from the LEC. What do you think of the scene so far?
It's good. The first question, any of you? Okay. It's good. LA is good. The food is good. People are good. Yeah, NA is good overall.
Good all around. Well, let's maybe find out a little bit about the players and the talent, because I remember watching you 2018 Worlds. You had a crazy champion pool. You were making all of these wild plays. So when you look at the mid lane talent in the LCS, who's your biggest competition here?
I'm not sure yet, but I guess I will discover. I think there are just many legends and experienced players in LCS, so I'm looking forward to play against everyone. I still have to see who is the most the best mid lane in NA and stuff like that. It's been only 1 week of practice so far, so.
Do you think that you have a different play style from the majority of LCS players?
Well, I come from Europe, so I guess, yeah.
What makes a difference?
Just we are a bit more crazy in Europe, I'd say. In NA, it's more like controlled, I'd say.
Controlled, all right, that's fair to say. We saw your CEO, Nicole, standing off to the side, asking you for the evil laugh. I won't make you do that, but I did see the Twitter video of you holding the flamethrower. So what evil act did you do today?
Well, just to say that was a fun day, like holding a flamethrower and laughing was a fun day indeed. Today, I was looking to get a WR just one-shotting everyone in game, but that was the evilest thing I could do, but I'm not sure what I could do.
Yeah, that was pretty nasty. Now, I know that you just said that you like LA for the food and everything, but you're coming from Naples, Italy, birthplace of the pizza. Have you tried American pizza yet?
No. like I'm actually... I'm not touching carbs at all when I'm not in Italy, because I just... Like, there is a reason to eat carbs in Italy, but outside of Italy, like, I don't see why I wouldn't eat steaks and stuff, because carbs are just bad, like, everywhere. Like, pasta, pizza, it's just bad. Like, it's uneatable, you know? Just... Like right now I'm on keto diet, I just eat many proteins and that's it, but just, yeah. I just don't like to eat carbs outside of Italy, pretty much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jizuke, the mid laner extraordinaire and also nutritionist. Congratulations again on the win. And for everyone else, stick around, because right after the break, we're going to see Team Liquid take on TSM.